This is a story about Navy SEAL training and deals with one particular problem that happened during Hell Week. The title of the story is Last Man Standing. While Hell Week provided a long list of memories, one that ranks high on that list relates to the time our class spent at the mud flats. Mud flats. In actuality, it was a waste depository for the base hospital, as well as a reservoir of soupy sludge located on the bay side of the Silver Strand, south of Coronado. The mud flats has a distinct odor, similar to, but more pungent than rotten eggs, and serves but one purpose: training those individuals aspiring to enter the ranks of the UDT SEAL teams. There is a reason for training in the mud flats, just as there is a reason for everything we did during Hell Week, or for that matter, BUDS. Apparently, during the Korean War, frogmen were required to swim up rivers that were filled with dead and decomposing bodies. As you might imagine, the stench was horrible, and some of the men found it difficult to function under these conditions. However, they did what had to be done and learned to acclimate themselves to these adverse conditions. After the Korean War, it was decided that BUDS training required an element that exposed trainees to similar conditions. The mud flats would be well suited to fulfill that need. It was day three when we launched our inflatable boat small into the bay and struck out for the mud flats. During Hell Week, your IBS goes with you practically everywhere you go. The IBS is extremely important because it is one of the more frequent means by which men are deployed or inserted into a combat area. It is also your lifeline when leaving a hostile beach for your mothership or submarine. Therefore, the instructors expect you to develop a love affair with your IBS and treat her better than you would your wife or girlfriend. As we paddled toward our objective, the stench of the mud flats caught our attention long before we actually arrived. Upon arrival, the instructors then ordered us to get acquainted with this lovely spot we would call home. With that, we waded into the mud flats, which is roughly waist deep. That angered the instructors, who then ordered us to dive into the mud. We did as we were ordered, and thus began a series of exercises devised by the instructors. These included calisthenics and seeing who could stay completely submerged under the mud for the longest period of time. By now, we were totally immersed in this muck, and to the delight of the instructors, the fun began. For the next several hours, boat crew competed against boat crew in various exercises ordained by the instructors. Then we were told that it was lunchtime and that we were to take a seat in the mud. Here we sat, covered with mud from head to toe, as the instructors started throwing box lunches to the class. The mud did not serve as a deterrent, and we ate our lunch with much enthusiasm, mud and all. When finished, we were ordered out of the mud and to the top of one of the sand dunes. Then, one of the boats was overturned at the base of the mud flats near the bottom of the dune. The instructors ordered us to assemble as boat crews and then, one man at a time, run down the sand dune and dive into the mud. The IBS would serve as a platform to the dive. The performance of our dive would be judged and scored by the instructors, and points awarded based on performance. You know, similar to scoring the Olympic diving. With that, we started the mud dives for glory and points. If you performed a satisfactory dive, approved and appreciated by the instructors, you were allowed to dive again. Some of the divers were actually stuck waist deep, head first, in the muck. If it weren't for another trainee jumping in to pull the man out, he would have suffocated. Once in that muck, it became impossible for a trainee to extract himself without the help of another. Time after time, the winners went back up to the top of the hill again and again. Before long, most trainees came to the realization that winning the diving contest wasn't everything it had been built up to be. Most performed an unimpressive dive, took their punishment, and retired to the spectator seats in the mud. One thing you should know, if the instructors felt you were not putting forth 100% on each dive, you would be in for untold punishment dealt at their hands. The diving contest went on for several hours before a winner was finally declared. We then went back to compete in countless mud-related exercises that continued until the sun started to go down. At this point, we were ordered into the bay to wash the mud off as best we could, and then to paddle our boats back to our training area. At our barracks, we were allowed to take a shower and change into clean fatigues. We found that the stench of the mud flats had not only permeated our clothing, but also our skin, making it impossible to wash off, no matter how hard we tried. It would be at least a week before the smell of the mud flats finally dissipated from our bodies. As for the clothes we wore that day, we were ordered to throw them in the dumpster. The instructors knew that the smell of the mud flats could never be removed from the clothing. Then, after showering and changing into dry fatigues, we were ordered to fall in outside of our barracks. From there, we were ordered into the bay where we dog paddled and sang songs for about an hour. We then formed up and ran to the mess hall for dinner prior to starting our next night problem. We were not yet halfway through Hell Week, but had already spent roughly 68 hours of this training cycle without sleep. Each day of Hell Week became ever harder, never easier, and I guess that is why they say, during Buds, the only easy day was yesterday. If you enjoyed this story and would like to read more, you can purchase a signed copy of my book by going to www.udt-seal-stories.com. Or if you prefer the Kindle version, go to Amazon.com books and type in Nick Nicholson. Thank you.